You may go, wow, what an experience. Or you might say, this guy needs to be in the loony bin. Okay. So I'm just prepping you for the moment. All right. So I was born in 1975 in Seoul, Korea. Okay. And as soon as I was born, the very day I was born, the doctor said there's a good chance he's going to die. Unfortunately, I was born with, I don't know what happened, but my intestines were all coiled up. They weren't in their proper place for whatever reason. So they said he has a 50-50 chance of living. Fortunately, the doctors, using modern-day medicine at the time and some traditional Korean medicine, they were able to fix my intestines. So I had the ability to move on. 3 months, so after I was born, my parents decided that we want to provide a better life for our son. So we're going to go to the United States of America, and we are going to make his dream come true. He's going to be a doctor, and they had this grand idea, right? Grand dream for me. So they came to the U.S., but however, because I was so young, remember, I was just born, I was so young, they decided to leave me with my aunt and uncle temporarily until they can come here and establish themselves. They came to Chicago, to make a long story short. They were working multiple jobs, and in the in between shifts, my mom usually came to the apartment where they were at, and she rested for a little bit before she moved on to her next job. Unfortunately, a burglar broke in. She didn't understand English, what he was trying to say. He asked her not to look at his face, but she did. So she was shocked. So I never got to know my mother. So I lost her at the age of 3 months. Right. It took 3 years before my dad was able to emotionally gather himself so he can bring me over to the United States. So I didn't see my father for the first 3 years of my life either. So he finally brings me over. By that point, he was remarried. But things didn't work out, so I had to go back to Korea. And I permanently immigrated to the United States at the age of 7. That's when I came. So, I moved to Koreatown. We call it K-Town now. But we moved to Koreatown, and I was raised there. And I was bored out of my mind. I didn't have any siblings. My dad was always at work. My grandmother was there, but she was always watching TV. So I was bored out of my mind. So I was kind of walking around one day. This was around, I was around 9 years old. And I happened to notice a church. It was a Sunday church at the time. I didn't know anything about baptism or anything, by the way. So I was like, well, I'll just go there. Right. Now this is a spoiled kid, you have to imagine. Right? A single child raised by grandmother. Okay, I got everything I wanted for a while, right? So I go in there, I put my arm and I'm just listening, right? To the stories that they're oh, welcome, come on and sit down. So I never heard of the Bible, I never heard of Bible story before. So the first story, there's this kid named David, apparently, right? And he throws a stone at some giant and takes him down. I'm like, oh, this is interesting, right? So it caught my attention, so I started listening a little bit more intently. And then the part that really got to me was the people he saved tried to kill him. I was like, what? What kind of crazy story is this? Right? So I started going to the church more and more because I was very intrigued. Eventually we got to the Daniel story and, you know, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I was just fascinated by the whole thing. Do you think that was chance that I ended up on another church? No, God was coming after me, right? When I wasn't even seeking, I wasn't even looking, I didn't even know what I was supposed to look for. He came after me very early on, right? So later on, I was about 13 years old, my dad comes in through the door and he's like, son, we got to go to church on Saturday. I'm like, why? He's like, look, this is how simple it was. He goes, say, come, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, Saturday. I'm like, oh, okay. No Bible studies. No. I was like, oh, that makes sense. 7th day. And it, you know, shows me the Bible. Yeah? I gave my first sermon at the age of 14. The pastor asked me to give a short sermon on faith, and I was on fire all of a sudden, right? And I eventually went to the East Coast, and I became a coal porter for like 7 years. Oh man, if you want testimony, you guys are talking about testimony at Sabbath school, coal porter. You want to see God work, man, that's the field to be in. But anyway, I was a coal porter for a while. Then I went to Heartland College. I don't know if you guys are familiar with it. It's a self-supporting school out in Virginia to study, to become a pastor. And then consequently, I ended up in Napa Valley, California, down the line, to become a youth pastor there. For I was a youth pastor for 3.5 years. I was on fire. I was giving sermons up and right, I was cold quartering. I was just like, man, this is awesome, right? But here's the thing. When I came into the church, I came in under legalism. I was taught to go to church on Saturday. I was taught to not eat meat. I was taught to do this and that and that and that. And I was trying to do all these things. And consequently, what happened was, I started judging myself almost on a daily basis. And I don't know if any of you have ever experienced that, but it's a miserable life. I could not help myself by thinking, there's no way I'm good enough. I didn't do that. Oh, I failed to do it here. I failed that. I failed this. And with that foundation, I crumbled. My faith went out the window. Things started to go haywire in my life. Okay? I didn't get hit by a car. Okay? I'm not kidding. I got hit by a car multiple times in my life. And I ended up at ER. I mean, the whole shebang. And, you know, I was just like, and at one point, I was just like, what is this all for? Right? I could not figure it out for the life of me. So, in 1997, I was clinically depressed. And consequently, I ended up becoming suicidal. And in 1997, I was 2 hours away. I was actually counting down the hours. I had it all planned out. I had the location planned out. I had the vehicle that I was going to take with me to. I had everything planned out to the T so that I could end my life in 1997. And as I was sitting there at one of the members' houses, I was sitting there just counting my time, counting my hours. And it was during lunchtime, so we were eating lunch and whatnot. So one of the kids from the, it was like a potluck kind of situation, but it wasn't Sabbath, you know what I mean? Anyway, so we were all gathered together, we were eating, and then one of the kids came in, teenagers came in and said, Simon, you have a phone call. Remember, this is 2 hours before. So I picked the phone, and it was a very good friend of mine from Virginia that I studied with. I was like, how in the world did you find me, first of all? Because I haven't talked to you in like 2-3 years, right? How did you find out where I was? How did you get this number, right? I'm just at some random person's house. And she said, yeah, it took a lot of trouble. She said, I had to call your pastor, and then he told me to call this. Then it took me like 5 or 6 times before I finally got you. I said, okay, so you got me. What's going on? And she's like, I'm coming out to see you. I bought a ticket. I was just like, ooh. You need to refund out this, right? I got church, I got school, I got office. And no, this is not a good time at all. You need to refund that ticket. She's like, it's non-refundable. God, really? 2 hours? It would have been all 2 hours. Fine, when you come now, right? So she's like, we'll be out there 2 weeks. Okay. So in my head, I'm like, I could postpone this, right? It's all good. Schedule over here. Right, so she came out, and again, to make a long story short, in the midst of all that interaction with my friend, I changed my mind. Obviously, standing in front of me, yeah, right? And so, from that point on, boy, but that didn't just prevented me from ending everything. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. My problems were still there. The darkness was still there. And so I ended up leaving the church. I looked up to God. I looked up one day and I said, leave me alone. I said, I don't want you anymore. Okay, this isn't atheism, folks. I wasn't like trying to say that there is no God. I knew there was a God, right? But I didn't want anything to do with it. Because ever since I started working for it, everything started to go downhill. And I was like, I don't want that anymore. Let me just go to hell. That was what I told him. I said, leave me alone. Okay? And of course I can't say it here, but I didn't curse him at one point. I'm gonna admit that. I was that angry. Right? So I ended up for 20 something years, I ended up doing all sorts of things. I was the general manager for Pizza Hut at one point in time. I was also a front desk manager for a 5-star hotel in Eugene, Oregon one time. I also worked at a dental office for 3.5 years. I worked at the list goes on and on and on. And eventually I went to the University of Oregon and got my master's in teaching. Okay. And then I started teaching in Idaho Falls, Eugene, Oregon, and now, of course, I'm teaching at Beavis. But before I ended up at Beavis, when I was teaching at the public school, the public school system really cares a lot about the points and the scores that the kids get, yes? So I don't teach that way. I don't like teaching to the scores. And I'm just giving you this synopsis because as a result, I ended up leaving the teaching field for 1 year because I had to really reevaluate my goals and what I wanted to do with life, right? I was like, do I really want to teach kids that scores is what matters in life, right? And that's all there is. When I went home, I felt empty. I didn't feel like I taught them anything. I just helped them basically memorize a bunch of information and wanted to regurgitate it, right? So I did not want to teach that way. So I left and I started working at the Citibank call center in Boise for about 1 year, okay? And boy, after getting yelled at every day for a year, it's like, what do I want to do, I knew it was temporary, but I didn't know how temporary it was going to be. And here we go. Are you ready? This is where the story really begins. Okay. At the time, when I left the public school system, I was divorced from my first marriage. I was going through the divorce of my first marriage. And so, between that and not being able to put my foot in something that I really want to do, I just lived it at home. My life was, it had no purpose, right? And so, again, I was falling into the danger of becoming depressed, very depressed, yes? And so I was renting out a little one bedroom out of a house, okay? I didn't even rent an apartment, I was just lying there one day. This was about 1 year after working at City. And I hear, trust me. Right? And did I tell you that by this point I'm already seeing counselors, yes, and psychiatrists, because I'm on 3 different antidepressants at this point. So, trust me. I'm like, oh man, I better call my psychiatrist tomorrow. Now I'm hearing voices. That's what I said. Tomorrow I'm calling a doctor, lawyer. Yes? I'm like, I'm calling. So, and then, but the voice wouldn't leave me alone. It says, trust me. So I find, I was just like, okay. So this is what I did. I literally did this. All right, listen. I don't know what's going on. I don't know if this is a med, right? Affecting my brain. Or if this is really you, I don't recommend you do this with God. I don't know why he deals with me, okay? Because I was in kind of like a stupid mode at the time. So I wanted this. I said, okay, listen, this is the deal. If this is really you, this is what I need. At heart, I'm a teacher. I am so sick of working at Citibank, right? I said, I want a school where I have the autonomy to teach the pedagogy that I was trained to teach, yes? And I need that freedom, okay? And then help me get back back to church. Okay? We haven't been in church for like 20 plus years, right? Remember? 1997, right? So I was like, you help me get those two things lined up, fine, I will trust you. Okay? Two weeks passed by, I totally forgot about the incident. Okay? 2 weeks passed by. And all of a sudden I get a call from Venus, Boys and Ballet after school. The teacher at the time was Dan Tyler. He called me and said, "Hey, this is Dan Tyler from Boys and Ballet after school. We met once, you remember that? Anyways, can you call me, can you give me a call when you get a chance?" And I was just like, okay. He left me a message, right? And I'm listening to this, sitting at City Bank, right? What? So I was just like, he must need some help with the graduation, because it was in May when he called me. So I thought he might need some help with graduation services or whatnot. Remember that boys 2 weeks ago?
Yep.
They came back. The boys said, "He's going to offer you a job." And I said, right, now I'm really losing it, right? But anyways, hey, Dan's like, "Hey, Simon, listen, here's the thing. I have some health issues and I have to retire early." Okay? I was like, "Really?" He's like, "Yeah, so listen, we're looking for someone, and for some reason, I have no idea why, but he said, your name keeps ringing in my ears just over and over and over again. It won't leave me alone. I think you need to apply for this job." Really?
Praise the Lord.
Alright. No, but you don't understand. I am stubborn. That's my life. Okay, I am very, very stubborn. So even in that moment, maybe most of the guys were like, "Oh, God's really working for me." I'm like, not convinced yet. Okay, so I'm like, "All right, when do I need to apply by? When do I need to turn the application? Can you do it by Friday?" It was Tuesday. I was like, I wasn't even planning on applying for any jobs. I have no reference letters. I have no resume. I have no cover letter. I have nothing. You want me to produce all that in the next 3 days, right? And get my job, and I say, okay, I'll try. That's what I'm saying. I'll try. I'll see where this leads. So, believe it or not, I was able to get all that done in 3 days. Can you believe that? I was able to get 4 solid reference letters from the University of Oregon and from Idaho Falls and everywhere I can think of. And I submitted it at the conference office on Friday. On Thursday, as a matter of fact. I was able to do it on Thursday. So I turned it, I went in to the conference office. I don't know if you all been there. Have you met Connie?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Connie's sitting there. "Hi, Connie, I'm Simon. I'm just turning in an application for the job with you." She's like, "Oh, great. Our superintendent's at lunch right now, but he'll call you if he likes what he's seeing on your resume." I was like, "All right, that's fair enough." So I'm walking out. I go to my car. I open the door, right? Remember the voice?
Yes.
"He'll call you tonight."
Oh.
At this point, I'm like, what am I to do, right? So I'm like, whatever, okay? This is all in my head. I'm in serious trouble. But this is for real, okay? This is something really brewing here, yes? So I go home. You know what kind of conference office closes? 5 o'clock. 4:30, they start packing up. You know what I mean? They start getting ready. It was 4:30. No call. Right? I'm like, I knew it. Right? I knew it. This is all kind of coincidence or whatever you want to call it. Okay? Energy, chi, whatever. Right? So, but for some reason, something was still lingering in the back of my head. There might be something to this. Yeah? So, 4:35. I don't know what made me do this. I just did this. You know it's 4:35. I kid you not, and I'm not exaggerating to the slightest of degree, okay? As soon as I said, "You know it's 4:35, right?" My focus. Just that quick. I was like, "No. This is not happening, right? There's no way." So I look at the phone, unidentified. I don't know who this is, right? So, hello? "Hey, sir, this is Patrick from the conference office." I was like, "Yeah, I'm kidding." So he's like, "Hey, do you have a minute to talk?" Well, that minute turned out to be like an hour and a half conversation, right? We're talking about, like, what is your philosophy of education? How would you handle the classroom if this happened? That? And I was just like, we talked for an hour and a half. I was like, hey, Simon, I really like you. But I gotta get transfer this to the, I gotta let the board look at it. If the school board likes it, we'll give you the interview. Okay. Sure. But, you know, I did not tell this story so far to anybody in my family or anywhere else, because you know why? I didn't want any outside influence. Does that make sense? If this was gonna happen, it had to happen just between me and him. Nobody else. So I didn't tell a single person. Even to my kid, I didn't even tell my kid. I just kept it to myself. So anyway, so I hang up the phone, right? 2, 3, 4 days pass by, no call. I know that they have to make a decision quickly because, why? It's at the end of May, folks. They're about to go on a summer break, right? So they need to hire someone fast, and they're not giving me a call. Remember that stubbornness? Yeah, it's all coincidence. There's no way this is really, I knew it. Okay, here I go again. Sometimes, I used to blame the Israelites for being so stupid, but I look at my own mind, I'm just like, yeah, okay. I see why. But anyway, told you, it's been a while, right? Hold on a second. I'm getting old. where was that? Somebody help me out.
4 days.
4 days past the
4 days past five. No calls. I'm giving up hope. Right? It's Friday again. And sorry, 9 p.m. No one's working at that time. I'm like, this is over. There's no way. We're about to hit June. And, yeah, so I'm about to shut off my phone to go to sleep. As I'm about to shut off my phone, the voice. Oh, here we go again. The voice says, they will give you the interview. Okay. What else can I say? Right?
Are you sure?
Yeah. Okay. So I was about to shut off my phone, and as soon as that voice came in, my phone dinged. Go ding. I'm like, what? Okay, I might as well check my mail before I go to bed, right? This is Patrick Fry. The board would like to give you an interview on Tuesday. Can you come in? I'm like, how can I say no at this point? So I said, Tuesday, fine, Tuesday. You think it's all said and done, right? It's all good, golden, right? Tuesday morning comes up. I wake up with a cough. I have some allergy, severe allergies that I suffer from, but this was like no allergy like in this world, okay? I woke up coughing every 30 seconds. Have you ever suffered from a cough like that? Every 30 seconds, I started coughing and coughing to the point of by noon, I was so sore, okay? I was like, I could taste the blood down the back of my throat. You know what I mean? But it was that bad. I'm like, oh, what is happening here? How am I supposed to do an interview with this cough, right? So I'm like, what's happening? I mean, if you give me this interview, I need to be able to do this interview, right? But how am I going to do this now? So I go to Walmart, like at 1 o'clock, I buy every cough drop that says powerful, maximum strength. I do it, I'm like, whoa. Good joke. I should have mixed some of those together. Okay. I can bounce and made it. I just chugged it down and I was just like, can't do that. So like the cough did not go away. Despite all the syrups and the cough drop, it would not go away. 6 o'clock rolls around. By the way, the meeting was at 7, the interview. Yeah. And so 6 o'clock rolls around, I'm getting into my suit and I'm just coughing. I take some Walmart bags with me so that just in case, because I started to get nauseous because of all the coughing. So just in case I threw up in the car, I had, you know, some Walmart bags. I put that in the car and here we go. To Beavis, here we go. So I went over there. As soon as I get there, the chairman said, can you just wait in the chapel for 10 minutes because we were finishing up the previous interview. So I said, take your time. So I go in the chapel, wait 10 minutes. I'm coughing still. I'm praying, coughing, praying, coughing. Chairman comes through the door and said, we're ready for you, Simon. I'm like, here we go. Okay, so I said, God, I really need them to postpone this for me. I just cannot do this, right? So that was my last prayer. I sit down. 13 people sat in front of me.
Uh-huh.
13. And each person was going to ask two questions. okay? But before I even let them out, my intention was, before anybody asks any question, I was going to say, wait, can we please postpone this because I have a massive cough and I can't sit to get rid of, right? That was my plan. As soon as I sit down, boom, right? Do you know, Don Driver, how many of you guys know Don Driver?
Yeah,
Don Driver. He didn't even give me a chance to take my first breath. So finally, we have a question for you. I was like, okay. So, like, looking at your resume, it says the last time you were active in the church was in 1997. Why do you want to come and work for us? Funny story. So I figured in my head, I'm going to tell him this story. And then I'm going to ask for the postponement. Yes? Okay, that's fair. I'm going to try to answer this question at the very least. How long do you think it's? About 20 minutes. How I ended up applying at Boise Valley Adventist School. I told them this exact same story with a little more detail, but I told them pretty much the story. And then I noticed something. It took me 20 minutes to tell that story. You know what I noticed?
You didn't cough.
Any guesses?
No cough.
I didn't cough. During the whole tour, I'm like, what? That's weird. Okay, well, you know, as long as I'm not coughing, I'll just keep going, right? So, first question, second question, 2.5 hours later, okay, way past 9 o'clock, Mark out, just kidding, Mark out. They said, thank you, Simon, for coming in. And I said, well, thank you. They said, we'll talk and we'll discuss it and we'll call you and we'll let you know one way or the other, right? So, thank you. Yeah, thank you for your time. And I walk out. As soon as I walk out, close that door.
Oh.
I mean, I was dying, okay? I thought all my innards are going to just come right out. I know, right? So I'm like doing this to a tree. Going, I mean, I was bent over for a good 15 minutes, right? Just like letting it all out. I was like, okay, I feel good enough to go home. It took me 10 minutes to go home, by the way. Okay, 10 minutes. I get home, and there's a recliner in my living room area, so I sat down. Relief, a little bit of relief, right? It's so stressful. Oh my God, so. Guess what? They'll give you the job. Okay. Phone rings. It was that fast. I kid you not, folks. Wait, Bob works super fast. He doesn't mess around. Phone rings. Pick it up. Hey, this is Patrick. I was like, okay. You have any questions that need to be clarified? Or he's like, actually, we talked, and we're going to offer you the job. Most people would say, thank you so much. Right? Thank you. I said, really?
Oh.
I was like, 15, 20 minutes. So I said, Ben, I said, thank you. But then I had to let Pat know what was going on, so, you know, from the very beginning. And I broke down. In that moment, I broke down. And I couldn't hold it anymore. And then I'm getting hired at Davis. And I go into the, I'm just going to give you a couple quick things that happened right away so that you can see how God works. Even when you think God did this amazing thing, he goes above and beyond. Okay, this is the crazy part. I go into the school. I remember I worked for the public school system with lots of money, okay? There were computers, there were smart screens, there was everything, right? I go into Adventist. Nothing. Where's my smart board? Right. Where are my computers? Where are my tablets? Where is anything, right? They're like, oh, we have a projector. So I go away. And then this giant, I'm serious, archaic dinosaur-ish thing. Where the fans running? This isn't going to work. I need computers. Where's your computers? Oh, we have a lab. Okay, now we're talking, right? I go into the lab, 15-year-old computers that barely works. So I go back to my room, like, you brought me here. You know how I teach. You know my curriculum. How in the world am I supposed to do this now? Right? Again, for the sake of time. Within weeks, a matter of weeks, I got a donation of $3,500. Private donation. $3,500. And it was to be used for technology. I said, okay, I could work with this. Wait, but how many laptops can I get? I have 21 students that I started out that year, right? I need 21 laptops, right? So I get online. And I find a warehouse. They were willing to give me brand new Chromebooks, okay, for $3,500 plus tax, right? So plus tax, it came out to like $3,700, $3,800, I forget what it was. But it was like in some sense, right? So I was like, even if I had to pay the extra couple hundred dollars out of my pocket, I need these computers. So I went to Jerry Essek, I don't know if you remember, she's our primary secretary. So she's like, I told her, I said, we need to order this. Okay, I'll pay the extra, come in the front, I'll pay for the taxes, right? And so she orders it, and she's like, wait a minute, hold on a second, this is what I love about Jerry. She's so, like, meticulous, right? I love it. She covers everything, right? So she's like, hold on a second, we're tax-free.
Oh.
I was like, okay, well, put it in, whatever, it doesn't matter, if it's a dollar or a couple hundred, I will pay for it, okay? So she calls the warehouse people, and they say, hey, by the way, this is our tax code, we're a tax-free organization. So they did all the calculation. By the time they did all the calculation, guess how much I got all the computers for? $3,500. Not a penny. Isn't that crazy? And I love to teach science and engineering, and I love to teach math, and that requires, and I use what we call project-based learning, so I get a lot of materials for science, right? And I'm like, ooh, I need some money now, right? This gentleman, I'm not going to tell his name, he likes to stay anonymous, he comes up to me after school, he's like, are you the new teacher? I said, I am. He's like, hey, I used to teach chemistry back in the day, 1980s.
Really?
Yeah. He's like, I know that it can get very expensive to teach science, so I want you to use this. So he gives me an envelope, right? I'm like, and I got both the donations in the public school too. No big deal, right? And I'm just casually opening it, and there's a check in there. It's not cash, it's check, right? And I see 3 zeros. It's like, what? $2,000. That's more than enough to cover all my expenses for the year, right?
Praise the Lord.
And again, I gotta figure this out. You're supposed to say thank you. But yeah, so those are two right away miracles that just happened right after the other, just to help me get started. But I mean, listen, if I had an extra hour, I could share with you more. But so that was my intro to Venus, right? And but no. I was having lunch with Pastor Troy. I don't know if you know him from Cloverdale Church. I was having lunch with him immediately after this incident, and I was telling him my whole story, and he's like, Simon, I am so happy for you. We are all excited for you, but you know what's going to happen next, right? And I knew it too, because I studied the scriptures before. You'd think it would be smooth sailing from there, right? Unfortunately, we have an adversary, yes?
Mm-hmm.
Oh boy, we knew the attack was coming, but I didn't know how fierce it was. He used the very church members, some of the church members, to attack him. He brought anger and just demonic type of spirit into the school. And that first year was the worst year of my teaching career ever. And I wasn't sure if I was going to survive. If it wasn't for the support system of the other people and the school and the administration, and especially Jerry, I wouldn't have survived that year, but God gave me that support system to get through it as well. And I just wanted to share this with you real quick. I found a quote during this whole thing, and it's from Ellen White. She says, the unity of the church is the convincing evidence that God has sent Jesus into the world as a redeemer. This is an argument which worldlings cannot controvert. Therefore, Satan is constantly working to prevent this union and harmony. Constantly. But that unbelievers, by witnessing backsliding, therefore, Satan is constantly working to prevent this union and harmony that unbelievers, by witnessing backsliding, dissension, and strife among professed Christians, may become disgusted with religion. Okay? God is dishonored by those who profess the truth while they are at variance and enmity with one another. This is the part that just shook me to the core. Okay, this is what it said. Satan is the great accuser of the brethren, and all who engage in this type of work are enlisted in his service. When these people were coming after me, making my life miserable, believe me, I wanted to retaliate. That human side just wanted to, or my flesh wanted to just consume them. Does that make sense? I mean, and this lesson, and I believe one of the things that I have to learn through this experience is to trust them. Like the very first thing he told me, right, that night when this whole thing started, was to trust them. No matter what happens, trust them. And here's the thing. From the very beginning of my life, when I was born, to this day today, okay, 43 years, right? God has been relentlessly pursuing me, no matter where I was. Like the scripture says, whether I'm deep down underground or whether I'm floating on cloud nine, it doesn't matter. He is relentlessly chasing people, and he's relentlessly chasing you too. And this is the crazy part, right, that I have yet to still understand. When I tell him, leave me alone, right? When I say, get lost, he won't listen. Right? He won't listen. And I tell you what, as an Adventist, growing up especially as a legalistic Adventist, I think this is one of those things where you can easily fall into the trap of looking at the laws and the rules, and don't get me wrong, I'm not here to preach, so let's get rid of school pops, okay, that's not what I'm here to preach. But what I'm saying is, we can get really focused on things, even the right things, if we forget that there's grace. Yes? You can focus on all the right things all you want, and that's what I tried to do. It didn't work. The foundation fell from underneath. It wasn't until I realized, no matter how bad I am, no matter what I, you know, don't want or whatever, God has his agenda, and his agenda is he bought you. Right? That's the bottom line. And I didn't understand that until recently in my life. And so, you know, I was supposed to share this talk with the Oasis Church about a month ago, but I locked out because I had other business I had to do at Cloverdale. So I was like, well, I thought that would, right? But in the back of my mind, I knew that God wasn't going to leave me alone. He wanted me to share this with you for some reason today, and I don't know why. It might be different for each and every one of you. Some of you might think, we got a call, right, in around hospital. I don't know, but I tell you what, you can't trust in him. And you guys were talking about at Sabbath school about testimonies. Well, that's my testimony.
Thank you.
Thank you. Father, Father in heaven, I want to thank you, but I, you know, the word thank you just doesn't do justice. How much you love us and how much you care for us and just what you do behind the scenes to protect us and guide us and to lead us is just absolutely unspeakable. And so, Father, as we move forward, I ask that you give us the understanding of what your love and grace is all about. And through that love and grace, help us to become obedient and help us to become your servants. And I ask that, Lord, I'm tired. I am personally very tired. We want to go home, yes? And so, Father, do whatever it takes. Make us your servants. Send us out there. Bring people to us. Whatever needs to happen, we will do your work, so that we can expedite this process and see you soon. And I pray all this in your name.
Amen. Amen.